Hello and welcome to EDP FSI. Today we have with us Gaurav Hinduja from Capital Float. Welcome on the show, Gaurav.
Hi, Isha. Thank you for having me here.
So, Gaurav, a lot of things have happened in the NBFC space. Start from moratorium 1.0 to 2.0. Then we saw FM coming out with many packages for NBFC with liquidity lines and on those lines. So, just wanted to understand, how are you seeing the NBFC space, first of all? And how do you see these measures which have come out from RBI and the FM consecutive?
Sure, Ishan. So as you can obviously imagine, these are challenging times, not just for NBFCs, but for every business, every lender in the country at this point in time. I think what really started was, and how the government and the RBI tried to help, was the right move of giving borrowers an option for a moratorium, which we would call moratorium 1.0. And I think that was the right move because the economy is struggling, SMEs are struggling. And so our stand as an NBFC was, during moratorium 1.0, was to give it to almost everyone who asked for it, because they were obviously struggling, and with the hope that we would get the same moratorium from our bankers as well. Obviously, given that there was confusion whether banks would allow and would actually give the moratorium to NBFCs, some gave, some didn't give, right? So I think it has been kind of challenging to make sure we manage well through a one-sided moratorium. And as we kind of look at now moratorium 2.0 that is starting, while we see clarifications have come from the governor of the RBI, banks are allowed to give it to the NBFCs. I think each bank is taking its own stance, whether it will allow it or not. Some definitely have. Some are still kind of working through it. And we hope that all of them will kind of realize the importance of the NBFC liquidity in the system and actually extend the same moratorium to us as well. Because our intent also is to extend it as far as possible to all our customers, right? Nothing has really improved in the economy for the last 2 months, and in fact it's probably gotten worse. So I think it is our duty to kind of make sure we are able to extend the moratoriums to our customers once we are able to get it from most of our lenders.
And how do you see the support coming from the FM, given that approximately 75,000 crore liquidity was provided in that sense? So how do you see that, those set of announcements, if there are any concerns over there?
Yeah, I think the a lot of interesting announcements have been made, and I'll just go through them one by one. So I think the first one that I think is of significance is for MSME borrowers, where the government has guaranteed loans that will be given to them. Now, there are interesting nuances to this program, because banks are allowed to give these loans at 9.5%, and NBFCs are allowed to give it at 14%. I think it's a great scheme for the MSMEs, and hopefully a lot of them will avail it. It, however, does become a little challenging for NBFCs to do these loans, because especially a lot of the mid-sized NBFCs typically borrow anywhere from 11 to about, let's say, 15-16%, right? So I think lending at 14% does make this make the economics of this new loan very hard to kind of digest. So the way we would look at this is, we would encourage a lot of our borrowers, and a lot of them do have lines, OD lines from banks, and we would kind of request them to go and make sure they're able to get the best out of these banks and able to kind of get these top-up loans. So that's kind of first. So on the first scheme, again, I wish there was some more flexibility in terms of the rates at which NBFCs could lend at. And hopefully there are some changes, but let's see how that kind of plays out. I think the second was schemes in terms of improving liquidity directly to the NBFCs, which is a 100% guarantee scheme. And then there's a partial guarantee scheme as well for loans to NBFCs. I think these schemes definitely are interesting. They look good on paper. I think the question is, how soon can some of these really start to take shape, right? The clarifications have come out from the ministry and from the RBI. And I think what is important now is each bank actually starts to take them and actually start to roll them out. Again, some banks have expressed concern whether a 20% guarantee is also enough to cover loans to NBFCs. So I think each bank will have to take its decision. But I like the move that the government has made. I think it now has to channel it and make sure that the banks are actually giving this out. The third is the TLTRO scheme, which was TLTRO 1.0 was obviously for large companies. The 2.0 TLTRO was more for mid-sized NBFCs. While again, good on paper, I think most NBFCs, at least of the mid-size, are not seeing that kind of flow through, right? So in a nutshell, I think a lot of the schemes are there, but I think they seem to be getting stopped at the bank level for whatever reason around risk aversion, or they're just taking way too long, right? And so, like I was saying, justice delayed is justice denied. I think liquidity delayed also starts to become liquidity denied kind of issue, right? So I think speed is of the essence in all these schemes, because with every passing day delay, I think a lot of our borrowers will actually end up struggling even more.
Okay. A fair observation over there. Coming on to capital float, how was the lockdown phase and the crisis, as well as the economy slowly starts to open up? What kind of trends you have seen over there in terms of repayments, if any? Where are the demand coming from, and where, which pockets are where the industry is, you know, like there's no demand for credit in that sense.
Sure. So I'll start with the demand side, and then I'll go to the repayment side. Actually, on the demand side, given that we are diversified both into SME as well as consumer, we've seen a lot of demand coming in from the consumer side, right? And these are small ticket loans for purchases on online platforms where we have partnerships like an Amazon or a Make My Trip or a few others, right? And in fact, actually, since the lockdown around the mid of April and up to now, we've actually added almost close to 2 lakh new customers, which is amongst the highest that we've actually ever added in the last couple of years. And this is all primarily on the consumer side. So I think there's a lot of demand for small ticket kind of loans on the consumer side. And this is, we feel, is good credit, because obviously we have to validate whether a lot of them are still employed, etc. And so I think we are confident on that side. And we see that the trend of obviously purchasing online and seeking credit for those online purchases is only going to increase from here on. On the MSME side, obviously, the demand is there, but there are challenges in terms of how do you assess credit worthiness of that demand at this point in time, and what is the liquidity support like we just spoke about to be able to give some of these larger ticket loans to SMEs. On the repayments, I think, again, because we've been fairly well diversified, we have seen good repayment trends within the consumer side, which is almost 80-90% of what we normally see pre-COVID. On the MSME side, again, we've got borrowers who are B2B businesses and B2C businesses. I think the B2C businesses, obviously, it's been much harder on them. And so there, the repayment trends are much lower than we would have liked it to be. But overall, on the SME side, I think we've seen about 50-55% over the last couple of months in terms of repayment trends. So while obviously it's much lower than normal, I think given circumstances, I think it's a pretty kind of decent repayment trends that we've seen. So far, I think what will be interesting now is really what happens in moratorium 2.0. How many people are going to apply for it, and what is the position of a lot of these businesses starting June and July?
Okay. So have you started lending to your existing borrowers if there is any demand coming from?
Yes. Yeah. So we started for a few, very few on the SME side. But like I said, on the consumer side, we've been given a lot more loans to our existing borrowers. I think almost, I would say, 30,000-40,000 of our existing borrowers on the consumer side have taken loans in the last couple of months. On the SME side, it's a very small number. So like I said, on the SME side, I think we will still wait to see the liquidity support that's coming in and actually rolled out, and wait for businesses to actually open before we can start to give them more loans.
Okay. So how's your borrowing mix looking like? How have banks provided you support in terms of the moratorium? And what are your future plans in terms of raising debt over here?
Yeah, so we typically borrow from 3 sources. We are mainly private banks, larger NBFCs, and HNIs and family offices. On the larger NBFC side, unfortunately, a lot of them have not been able to extend the moratorium to us because they are fighting the same battle themselves. So hopefully that improves that they can extend the moratorium. On the private bank side, like I said, some have, some have not. And those who have not are actually trying to be creative and work with us and say, instead of giving a moratorium, we may give you a smaller term loan to kind of ensure liquidity is where it is needed. And on the HNI side, we've not necessarily asked for moratoriums because obviously these are not large institutions. That said, we entered the whole lockdown phase with a good amount of cash in hand. And so I think we are comfortable from that position. But obviously, we want to make sure we are able to shore up enough liquidity that will allow us to not only weather the storm, but also be able to do a good level of disbursals for the next few months. And so we are engaging with banks, again, to kind of extend new lines, whether it's someone like a SIDBI or someone else. And we have been able to get one or two kind of new lines to be able to do new loans. So I think let's see how this plays out over the next month before we can actually start to utilize some of those lines.
So 2 more points. How has the operational impact been on capital float, and how have you re-strategized for the coming months? What are your plans in that sense?
Sure. I think from an operational impact, the biggest one has been right now around collections, right? Because especially while we do a lot of telecollections and we've been able to set up work from home collection centers in people's houses, I think that has worked well. Obviously, in terms of on ground and feet on street collection, that has been a challenge because most cities are still in a red zone. That said, we've actually segregated our portfolio depending upon whether it's a red zone, green zone, orange zone. And we've actually begun field collections a couple of weeks ago in certain kind of green and orange zones. And that will only kind of increase as we go forward in the next few weeks. I think we've adapted as a company fairly well to work from home, even though we've just actually opened the office last week onwards. But we have only about 10-20% of staff coming in at this point in time. And most people still continue to work from home. And I think as we look at the next 6 months, I would see at least 40-50% of people continuing to work from home and managing social distancing through that means in the office. So I don't see too much disruptions actually in our work, like I said, except for collections, and that should hopefully start to get better as the unlock 1.0 actually starts to play out.
Okay. Specifically on collections, what are the trends you're seeing over there, and what is the shift in your collection strategy apart from the telecalling which you're doing from work from home? How tech can be enhanced more over here?
Yeah, so I think we use a lot of interesting things, right? So, like I said, apart from telecalling, we do a lot of communication through SMS, IVR blast, WhatsApp, etc. Obviously, keeping in mind frequency, keeping in mind privacy of the customer. I think we also kind of work through partners where the people shop online, etc., and have them to say, okay, you should kind of be pay aligned. We have an app called Walnut, which actually has a lot of data about a customer, right? So we use that data to kind of nudge a customer to make sure that repayments actually come in. We are now working on an automated bot for making kind of calls as well, right? So I think over the last couple of years, we've developed a fairly robust collection stack. And I think that's really starting to help and play out now. Obviously, it needs to be supplemented with humans. And so as the lockdown 1.0 improves, I think we'll start to see much better collection rates.
Okay. One last question. Going forward in the coming months, how do you sort of shift your underwriting strategy over here? Because a lot of disruption has happened. Many data points won't be relevant as such. A new data points might come because on the consumer side, either there could be job losses or reduction in salaries. And on the SME side, there could be a mismatch in the cash flows in that sense. So how would you approach the underwriting over here?
Yeah, so the data points and the ingress channels for the data will not change. I think what we will look at is how do you really utilize some of that data and what are the policies you develop on top of that data, right? So like you rightly said, on the consumer side, I think we will look for stability of income. We will look for income variabilities if they've been decreased. And I think we'll have to figure out a way in terms of how do you monitor stability in income, not just at the time of giving the loan, but once you've actually also already given the loan, right? So that's something that we've already kind of designed, and our app actually goes a long way in helping and ensuring that. On the SME side, I think the challenge will be really how do you ensure that people have demand side issues that have been solved, right? And how the revenues, obviously, it's going to be lower than what it was. But I think the question is, how much lower is it going to be? Have people taken moratoriums? What has been their behavior during the moratorium? What was their position before the moratorium? Obviously, you can no longer, at least for a while, look at or be very strict in terms of leverage ratios. So you will obviously kind of look at tweaking some of those models because you won't hold good at least for the next few months. So I think this is a work in progress, and it will be interesting to see how a lot of the SMEs stack up against the industry benchmarks.
All right, Gaurav, those were some really great insights. Thank you so much.